Hello, my name is Joe Fontana. I'm very happy to be here. I thank Dr. Goldbach-Mansky and the conference organizers for allowing me to be here. So I'm going to try to run through this pretty quickly, just a brief overview. I won't get into the weeds too much, and I have no disclosures. So we'll talk a little bit about the presentation, pathogenesis. We'll go over the diagnosis. Briefly talk about differential diagnosis. Dr. Wooter's already covered a lot of that. And go over some biomarkers and tests, and briefly touch upon some of the treatment trials that have been used, and go over a few of the complications and prognosis of the disorder. So sarcoidosis is a multisystem disorder. Some people consider it multisystem. In any event, it often affects women more than men, and often affects African Americans more than Caucasians. Typically, patients will present with some type of pulmonary symptom, such as cough, shortness of breath, and often complain of fatigue. They will have, will have adenopathy in the hilar regions, and they may go on to have more dyspnea as the disease progresses. So there are multiple organs can be involved, including the spleen. The brain can manifest as having a cognitive dysfunction or a bulbar palsy. In more advanced pulmonary disease, you may get fibrosis with a cavity forming, and you can have let me see if I can get this to work. Yeah, there we go. So we can have aspergilloma forming there. This particular study showed a typical distribution. What we found where the lungs are most commonly involved, about 95% of the cases, skin, lymph node, and eyes to follow. Liver can also occur with some regularity. Erythema nodosum is often thought to be a good prognostic marker for spontaneous remission. Calcium elevation is thought to be due to vitamin D dysregulation with an increased conversion from inactive vitamin D to active vitamin D, leading to increased calcium uptake. Cardiac involvement occurs about 2 to 5% of the time, and that's the way it's clinically manifested. However, in postmortem studies, it can show up in about 50% of the cases. Disease pathogenesis, there's a prevailing hypothesis in sarcoidosis. Since we do not know what the etiology is, the prevailing hypothesis suggests that there's an antigen or one or more antigens that lead to an exuberant and dysregulated immune response in a predisposed host. A number of GWAS studies have demonstrated multiple candidate genes, such as annexin A11, BTNL2, and HLA, a number of HLA risk factors, risk alleles. So in terms of the cellular response, T cells become activated, they elaborate IL-2, and there's predominantly a Th1 polarized response manifested by interferon gamma release, and there's a oligoclonal proliferation, which is suggestive that there was an antigen process all along. Th17 cells are increased and play an active role. T regulatory cells may have somewhat of a paradoxical function, perhaps leading to peripheral T cell energy that's observed in sarcoidosis patients. Macrophage activation is thought to be important for granuloma development and maintenance and TNF release. And Th2 responses can lead to disease resolution or can contribute to a fibrotic process. So differential gene expression studies have also informed us in a number of ways. They've identified various pathways such as cytokine-cytokine signaling, natural killer cell signaling, and JAK-STAT signaling as well. The protein-protein interactions from a bioinformatics approach have suggested that STAT1 is an important player, and as you can see here, that it's present in at least two of these pathways, interferon gamma receptor 1 is also present as well. The diagnosis is often challenging because, as you have already heard, there are a number of granulomatous diseases that look something like sarcoidosis. There's no known cause, and it's not a single gene that we can do a genetic testing on. So, consequently, this is a disease that it's a diagnosis of exclusion, and it puts the burden on the clinicians to use a great deal of diagnostic reasoning to make or exclude all other competing diagnoses. With the advent of newer technologies such as electromagnetic navigation bronchoscopy and endobronchial ultrasound, transbronchial needle aspiration, access to intrathoracic lymph nodes and tissues is becoming easier and has pretty good operating characteristics. As you can see from the study by Tremblay, it's a randomized controlled trial. It had pretty good sensitivity of 83% and a good specificity using this particular device, where there's an ultrasound at the distal end of the bronchoscope and a needle, allowing us to visualize and distinguish a lymph node from vascular structures in the thorax. When combined with other biopsy methods, such as transbronchial lung biopsy, the operating characteristics further improve. And as you can see here, what was once thought to be a pretty good adjunctive test using BAL flow cytometry with a CD4-CD8 ratio greater than 3.5, it only had a 54% sensitivity. That said, it's not commonly recommended, but in cases where you're trying to distinguish sarcoidosis from hypersensitivity pneumonitis, it might be helpful. So, making the diagnosis, again, has been challenging, and the World Association for Sarcoidosis and other granulomatous diseases have come up with a rubric. They came up with highly probable, probable, and possible in terms of categories of clinical findings. And what I'm showing here is that just it's organ specific, so they have one for pretty much each organ system. And for the heart, you can see there's no highly probable clinical finding determined at the time. Other probable findings might include some type of arrhythmia or a cardiomyopathy. For the eye, again, uveitis would be a highly probable finding, making sarcoidosis a suspicious diagnosis. Again, you may see these mutton fat keratic precipitates, or in the retina, you may see candle wax type manifestations. In terms of the lungs, imaging is an important part of the diagnosis, and PET scanning are being used with somewhat more frequency, and it can also provide us with information about other organs of involvement. Skin may have a number of manifestations, and lupus pernio is considered to be a highly probable diagnostic finding. Now, in terms of, there was an attempt to quantitate this rubric, and Bickett and Dr. Boffman from the University of Cincinnati came up with this study to have a clinical score without a biopsy and a score with a biopsy. So as denoted here, it's SDS clinical and SDS biopsy. And they did have a validation cohort, and they came up with interesting findings. So they have various scores between 3 to 6 for the clinical group, and if you had a biopsy, your score went up to at least 6 and went up to 8. And the operating characteristics just for the clinical score alone without a biopsy were reasonably good, with good predictive values. However, the negative predictive value wasn't great. So again, the burden is on the clinician to drill down and to make sure that there's not a coexisting diagnosis or a competing diagnosis. If you have a biopsy, the numbers are a little bit better. So just to put this in somewhat graphic form, if you have a score of 4, you have a fairly high likelihood ratio, and your post-test probability is pretty good. Another way to demonstrate it, if you had a pre-test probability that you're uncertain about your patient, But if they had a reasonable score of 5 or more, then you would have a high, very high post-test probability of making the diagnosis without a biopsy. So what's the point of the biopsy? Well, there's still a role for it because for one example would be if your patient goes on to have latent disease, say we're into a neurologic manifestation, and you don't have tissue, it's not easy to get brain tissue at that point. You can't, CSF does help somewhat. Sometimes sarcoidosis, we're asked to do biopsies, and we find patients have both granulomas and lymphoma at the same time, so it's important to diagnose coexisting illnesses as well. What I'm trying to show is here is as the clinical score improves, the need for biopsy goes down. However, I just want to remind you that your negative predictive value is still problematic, and again, it's a diagnosis of exclusion. Differential diagnosis, again, Dr. Wooters covered this very nicely in her talk for granulomatous diseases. Just want to point out that we're finding a number of medications that are used to treat malignancies and other conditions are a source of granuloma formation. Again, in the pulmonary population, we see inhalation injuries from various heavy metals or even silica that can look somewhat like sarcoidosis. And inflammatory diseases such as hypersensitivity, pneumonitis, can have a similar picture. All right, so biomarkers and tests, I'm not going to go over this in very much detail, but I just want to talk a little bit about tissue pathology. Again, a granuloma is nonspecific, but there are certain things that you should be looking for in your patients. You want to see a compact, tightly fit granuloma as opposed to a loosely formed one, which you might see in hypersensitivity pneumonitis. If you do immunohistocytochemistry testing, you would expect to find more of a CD4 population within the center with giant cells present and macrophages. In the periphery, you see this nice swirl of CD8 cells and B cells and fibroblasts. So are there any other findings that are pathognomonic? Unfortunately not, but there's some that still could be helpful somewhat. You may see what are known as Schaumann bodies that have been described in 2 to 9%. Can also see calcium oxalate crystals with some frequency, asteroid bodies, and Hamazaki-Wessenberg bodies, which are important just to know about because they sometimes can be confused with a fungal element, and that can confound your diagnosis, of course. So we don't have a great biomarker in sarcoidosis, and serum angiotensin-converting enzyme has long been used, but it's been many times proven that it's nonspecific. It can occur, be elevated in lymphoma, tuberculosis, and other conditions. This one particular study suggests that soluble IL-2 receptor may be have an important role, and there are other supporting studies that would suggest that this is a reasonable biomarker to consider. So it has a sensitivity of 98%, a specificity of 94%, and a fairly good negative predictive value, certainly much better than the serum ACE or chest X-ray in a uveitis population. So corticosteroids are certainly the long-standing mainstay of therapy, but there have been a number of studies that have looked at steroid-sparing agents such as methotrexate, azathioprine, leflunomide, and mycophenolate. More recently, the anti-TNF monoclonal antibodies have been studied, actually in much greater numbers than the other agents. But the purpose of this figure that I'm trying to demonstrate here is that the y-axis is the patient number, just to show you that so few patients have actually been studied in clinical trials. These are pooled. This is not a valid statistical method, but these are pooled studies. Again, just to show you the response rate. In blue is no response. The orange represents response. And roughly, it's around 75% to 80% response rate based on a diverse population of studies here. Now, one of the downsides of sarcoidosis clinical trials has been the study methodology and design, whereas many patients were left on the corticosteroids, so it's possible that some of these agents may have been more efficacious than what's shown here. Nevertheless, this is what we have right now. Novel therapies include antibiotics. Drake from Vanderbilt has shown some efficacy. Note that this regimen that they've developed does include a macrolide, which may have some anti-inflammatory effects, but we don't really know why this appears to be effective, but it does seem to have some role. A study with a interleukin-1 monoclonal antibody study has been completed. We don't have the results yet on that. Phosphodiesterase inhibitors appear to have some anti-inflammatory effect and have been looked at in cutaneous sarcoid. Statins, we've studied them here, and the study's been completed. Our preliminary data suggests or has demonstrated that at least for one of our secondary outcome measures, which was flares, there was a relative risk reduction of 80% in the mild sarcoid group. There was an interesting and compelling case report in the New England Journal of Medicine with a patient who had been refractory to many, many therapies and was tried on tofacitinib and seemed to have a very good outcome. Rituximab has been tried. The results are somewhat mixed. Cell-based therapies may hold promise, but we need more data on them right now. So very briefly, I'll just go over some of the monitoring. Some suggest that IL-2 receptor and neopterin maybe have a role. Again, depending on the organs that are involved, you have to be very organ-specific. The end-stage effects of sarcoid can be quite severe and require significant interventions, such as a pacemaker or implantable defibrillator. End-stage pulmonary disease can lead to either severe fibrosis with respiratory insufficiency or pulmonary hypertension, and the treatments at that point would be transplantation. Just one point to go back on transplantation, there has been some recurrence of the disease in transplanted organs. Most patients, fortunately, don't have such severe outcomes. About two-thirds will have spontaneous remission within the first several years of diagnosis. But unfortunately, some patients go on to have chronic or remitting disease. Now, just to wrap it up briefly, sarcoidosis is a polygenic disorder, we think, and the impact or the effect size of the genes has not been fully defined in terms of risk and disease expression, but some candidate genes appear to play an important role. There are a number of cellular processes that have been identified that characterize the disease. It's mainly a Th1 polarized disorder, but Th17 does play an important role. Multiple inflammatory pathways have been identified and do include STAT1. As I said many times, or several times at least, sarcoidosis is a diagnosis of exclusion, so it's the burden's on the clinician to really work that up appropriately. Tissue can be helpful, but you can still derive a high probability diagnosis without it. And newer tools and technologies are making it easier to get tissue on these patients. And corticosteroids, while they're the mainstay of disease, and many patients have complained about them, and in fact, the quality of life seems to go down with chronic use. And unfortunately, we don't have a single superior therapy that's been established yet. But as I said, the prognosis is generally good, but a subset of patients can have severe and life-threatening disease. Fortunately, there are new therapies and management paradigms that are under investigation. So again, just want to thank you all for your attention and for the conference organizers. Thank you.